Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
Thank you. Stay standing if you wouldn't mind. Pastor made the woman's conference sound so inviting. I thought I might go sign up to attend it. Who was here this morning? Or yesterday morning? One of the other services. Forget how many they have now. Let's shout the word from the message, Live Strong. Ready?
Live Strong!
All right. You may be seated. Just for a moment. When I was going out from the meeting yesterday morning, a gentleman came up to me, and I think I got it right. The basic thing was, he gave me a whole lot of details, was that last time I was here, he was in the healing meeting and had leukemia, and was telling me that God had healed him. Come on, hallelujah. We thank the Lord for that. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Yeah. Newspaper reporter interviewing me one time said, "What do you have to say about those that don't get healed?" I said, "Well, it does concern me, and I just wish everybody get healed, but what I want to tell you is we celebrate those that are healed." Amen. Come on, hallelujah. That's certainly better than nobody being healed. When you read the Word of God, you come across some nuggets every now and then. And you go, whoa, that's awesome. And sometimes you've read it a million times, well, figuratively speaking, and you've heard about it, and you've sung about it, and it just gets a hold of you. And so tonight, for just a few minutes, I want to minister on one of those nuggets. If you've got your Bible, would you stand with me, please, to read the Word of God? The book of Proverbs, chapter 17, verse 22. A merry heart does good like medicine. Several verses say laughter does good like medicine. In the original Hebrew, it goes, a merry heart or laughter makes medicine even better. Dear God, when I was a kid growing up, my mother would give me some medicine. She would tell me the worse it tastes, the better it's doing you. Anybody have their mother tell them that? They were lying. Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight for the word of the living God. We pray tonight that your Holy Spirit will come and minister to the life, both spiritually and physically, in every possible way. I bind all the powers of darkness. I release healing of the soul and healing of the body tonight. Amen. In Jesus' name. And everybody shouted. Now lift your hands if you can, please. And for a minute or two, I want you to just shout your praises to God. Come on, hallelujah. Praise God. Keep shouting it to the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Whoa. Yes. Listen. was in San Jose last week, as most of you know. And one night I got up and said something like that, and it was just a very dignified, quiet, wasn't even a shout. I said, all right, let me put something on you tonight. If you went to a football game in this area, either the 49ers or the Raiders, and the place went nuts, I said, why can't you be that loud for God? Come on, hallelujah. Come on, are you hearing me? Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise God. Hallelujah. You may be seated. I found this article, it's very small, in a newspaper in London, England. And it was titled, Laughter is Best Medicine. And I read it to you. With all those rules about diet and exercise, the quest for a healthy heart is not always associated with fun. But researchers at the University of Maryland in Baltimore found 15 minutes of laughter a day works wonders for your circulation, widening the blood vessels, increasing blood flow, and helping reduce the risk of heart attacks and strokes. They studied the physiological effects of watching different types of movies and found that watching a good comedy has beneficial effects, but sitting through a more stressful story, such as a war film, can have reverse effects. They spent millions of dollars doing this study to discover that what the Bible says is correct. Come on, are you hearing me? Synonyms for the word laughing are happy, cheerful, jovial, merry, elated, joyful, rejoicing. We ought to learn to laugh. Come on. We ought to learn to laugh. The title of this small message is He Who Laughs, Laughs. Say that 25 times fast. He or she who laughs, laughs. Another article taken from an insurance claim form, the man explains, and here it is. It would have taken too long to carry the bricks down by hand, so I decided to put them in a barrel, he's several stories up, and lower them by a pulley which I fastened to the top of the building. After tying the rope securely at the ground level, I then went up to the top of the building. I fastened the rope around the barrel, loaded it with the bricks, swung it out over the sidewalk for a descent. Then I went down to the sidewalk and untied the rope, holding it securely to guide the barrel down slowly. But since I weigh only 140 pounds, some of you are ahead of me, the 500-pound load jerked me from the ground so fast that I didn't have time to think of letting go the rope. And as I passed between the second and third floors, I met the barrel coming down. This accounts for the bruises and lacerations on my upper body. I held tightly to the rope until I reached the top, where my hand became jammed in the pulley. This accounts for my broken thumb. At the same time, however, the barrel hit the sidewalk with a bang and the bottom fell out. With the weight of the bricks gone, the barrel now weighed only 40 pounds. Thus, my 140 body began a swift descent, and I again met the empty barrel coming up. This accounts for my broken ankle. Slowed only slightly, I continued the descent and landed on the pile of bricks. This accounts for my sprained back and broken collarbone. Now, I love this next part. I just love it. At this point, I lost my presence of mind completely and let go the rope. And the empty barrel came crashing down on me. This accounts for my head injuries. I don't know about you, but I thought it was hilarious. There is great blessing in laughter. Joy and laughter belong to the church of Jesus Christ. Come on, hallelujah. The week before I got saved, and some of you know the story, and I stood outside a building and watched what was going on, I never identified it as church because the people were happy. Getting cold in here now. I always thought church was dead and dry and no fun. The world has very little to laugh about. Emptiness, no hope, sorrow, despair. But we do know what we are about and where we are going. In our reading, a merry heart or laughter does good like a medicine. The word good in the Hebrew language simply means to advance powerfully the recovery. I would encourage you tonight, no matter what is wrong, whatever you're going through, what has happened, to begin to laugh in spite of what is happening. Come on. I am told laughter releases more endorphins than anything else. And is 200 times more powerful than a shot of morphine. A merry heart or laughter is not natural. It takes a conscious effort to keep laughing. There are five major ingredients when there's church growth through revival. Number one, there's a spirit of fellowship. People actually become friendly in church. There's a spirit of prayer. There's a spirit of worship. There's a release of the spirit of faith, and there's a great spirit of joy. Ecclesiastes 8:15 says, eat. Well, we know how to eat. You only have to look at some of us. Most of us. Drink and be merry. That's the command. Eat, drink, and be merry. The world says, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. but tomorrow we live. Even if we die, we live. Come on, hallelujah. Psalm 16, verse 11 says, in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. In the King James Version, in Psalm 5, verse 11, Psalm 63, verse 5, and Psalm 63, verse 11, it uses the word rejoicing, and in the Hebrew, this particular word of rejoicing means a louder joy. The only way I know to have a louder joy is to laugh. Come on. See, it's party time tonight. We are God's believers. We are God's party animals. And we are going to laugh our way out of sickness and hurt and wounds into health. We were talking this morning out back about how many miles Kathy and I have flown. It's a lot of miles. We get on airplanes and the crew greet us by name. And every now and then one of them say, oh, you fly more than our pilots fly. One time I was on a flight and they announced for us to keep our seat belts done up. Not to get up and walk around unless absolutely necessary. There'd been a small malfunction in one of the engines. That means it wasn't working. You could feel people tensing up. Man beside me goes, oh my God. And I went like this, ha, 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 out real loud, ha, 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 oh, ha, ha, ha. The guy beside, and then, I'll just tell you this, you know, when you start laughing, other people start laughing, and they don't know what you're laughing at. And the man says to you, hey, this is not funny. We're going to crash and die. And I went, ha, 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 oh, ha, ha, ha. I said, not while I'm on this plane. He said, are you some aeronautical mechanic or something? Went, nope, not even close. He said, then how come you know we're not going to crash and die? I said, I'm a Holy Ghost preacher. And God told me to go to this city and preach, and he told me what to preach when I get there, which means we're going to arrive. Ha, 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 ha. And he looks at me and he goes, you're an idiot. I said, let me tell you something. Even if it were to go down, it's better to go down laughing than crying. And we're not going down. As you can see, we arrived all right. Life, in spite of what happens, is about having fun until Jesus comes. Some of us have gotten too serious about ourselves. What we do is serious. Passion is one thing, but let's do it with joy and laughter. Psalm 118, verse 24 says, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and we will be glad in it. When we talk to people who don't know about praising God, we instruct them from the Word of God. The Bible says, I will praise the Lord. Amen. That means praise is a predetermined act of a person's will. I will do it. And then the enjoyment and the emotion follows. Well, here it says, let me read it to you again. This is the day the Lord has made. We will. That's a predetermined act of our senses. We will rejoice. And we will be glad. See, what we have to understand is it's not laughter of the emotions. The world has to hear something funny or hear something humorous, see something funny before they laugh. And that's okay. But we as believers need to understand we don't have to hear something funny. We don't have to see something that's humorous. We can just laugh. Come on, hallelujah. We can just absolutely laugh because laughter is part of the fruit of the Spirit. And one part of the nine parts of the fruit is joy. It's already in us. We can laugh at any time, at anything, anywhere. I preached the full message on this one plate, one church, and as we were going out, a lady says, you don't understand what I've been through. I can't laugh. I said, lady, you didn't hear what I had to say. You're exactly what we're talking about. In spite of what is going on, in spite of what is happening, we are going to laugh because the joy of the Lord is in us. In fact, in the book of Galatians chapter 5, where it talks about the fruit of the Spirit, it says, against such there is no law. There's no law against you laughing. Come on, hallelujah. You can't even OD on it. You can laugh at the devil. Come on, God laughed at the devil. You can laugh when you are in trouble. You can laugh at yourself. Laughter brings health. Proverbs 17, verse 22. In the Young's literal translation says, a rejoicing heart does good to the body. Come on, are you hearing me? Don't go, oh yeah. No, no. A rejoicing heart does good to your body. The Rotherham version puts it this way. A joyful heart works an excellent cure. The Knox translation says, a cheerful heart makes a quick recovery. Dr. Ern Crocker, who was once a great heart surgeon, said this, those who find it easy to laugh seldom have a heart attack because laughter releases stress and tension. Laughter ought to be a way of life for God's people. A marriage counselor said this. He never, ever had a troubled couple come into his office laughing. Might have helped if they did. Job no person has ever suffered as much as Job. And here's what he said. Job 5, verse 22. You shall laugh at destruction and famine. Job 8, 21. He will fill your mouth with laughter. Right in the middle of the greatest tragedy of all time, he says, God will fill your mouth with laughter. Wow. Proverbs 15, 13 says, a merry heart makes a cheerful countenance. Proverbs 15, verse 15 says, he who has a merry heart has a continual feast. Psalm 5, 11 says, let all those rejoice who put their trust in you. Psalm 9, 11, I will be glad and I will rejoice. Filipinos 4, 4. Just checking. Nearly said it again. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord, and always again I say rejoice. Laughter brings good health. We know that Jesus is the healer. Come on, can you say amen?
Amen.
I am not a healer, but I can point you to the one who is.
Amen.
Come on, hallelujah. Tonight, I'm here to tell you that people are going to be healed. This is the will of God concerning you.
Amen.
And in just a little while, we're going to minister to people. Right now, I'd like every head to be bowed, every eye closed, nobody moving around, nobody talking, unless you absolutely have to. And the first thing we want to pray for tonight is the greatest miracle that can happen to a human being. That is the miracle of Jesus coming into your heart and life and washing away all of your sin. So what are you talking about? Every human being, you, me, and everyone else, has been born into this world with an inherent nature of sin. But God said, I will not leave you like that. I will make a way out for you. And so his son Jesus went to the cross, and on the cross, he actually took the sin of all mankind upon himself. And he said, if you will make a choice, a decision, open up your heart and mind and invite me to come in, I will come in spiritually and wash literally all your sin away. So at that moment, you will be as if you've never ever sinned. This is your night. This is your moment. You're not here by accident. You're here in the plan and the purposes and the will of God. At this point, as we said this morning, people start making excuses within themselves not to do this. Here's some of the things they say within themselves. Well, I don't want to be religious. We don't want you to be religious either. Christianity is not a religion. It's about relationship. Well, I've got my church. We're not talking about your church, whether it be this one or somewhere else. We're talking about Jesus coming into your heart and life and washing your sin away. Well, I'm cool, man. All my family's gone to church for years, for generations. No. Nobody can make this choice for you. You have to make it for yourself. Well, I'll go home and think about it. That just is a polite way of saying no. What are people that know me going to think about me? If you live your life based on what people think about you, you are in really a tragic way. And so tonight, all over this great auditorium, in this wonderful church, we want to pray first. Men and women, young people, doesn't matter whether you're visiting for the first time, or you've been here one or two or three times before, or you become a regular attender. We want to pray for you, for Jesus to come into your heart, into your life, and to wash all of your sin away so that you're absolutely, positively sure that you belong to God and God is connected to you. And in order for me to do that, I'm going to ask you to respond very simply, as they have in all the other services. Just simply raise your hand. That's the indication you want me to pray for you, for Jesus to come into your heart and life. Put it up high. Hold it up so I can see it. It's a bit hard to see here, but just keep it up. Put it up. Let me count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. And that's half of the building. There's some more over there. There's some down near the front and on the side. There's some over the back over there. There's some over on my left, my right, in the front and at the back. God love you. Some up in the rooms there. You may put your hands down. If there's anybody else and you haven't raised your hand, quickly put it up right now. Just put it up. Let me see it and put it down. If there's anybody else. Yes, God bless you. Yes, God bless you. Yes, God bless you. Yes, God bless you. Over there. Put your hands down. Let's stand together. Please. I want you to hear me. This is important. When I get through giving you some instruction, I'm going to ask you to do what I'm instructing you to do. In just a couple of moments, I'm going to ask every person that raised their hand all over this crowd to push out through the people in your aisle, walk down the various aisles, and stand in a line across the front facing me so we can pray for you. Say, do I need to come? If it was worth raising your hand, it's worth coming down here. Jesus went all the way to the cross for you and I. This will not hurt you, it will help you. The Bible is very clear. If we confess Jesus publicly, he'll confess us before his heavenly Father. And we want you to know, we're not against you, we're for you, we love you. And most of us have made this choice, this decision, somewhere, sometime, almost in the same way. If you need somebody to come with you, and I'm serious, just grab somebody and say, come with me. So I don't even know them. I won't hurt. They love you. If you brought somebody, politely invite them to come and receive Jesus and come with them. Right now, over here, in here, all a whole bunch in here, over here, up in the rooms. Come on down and stand at the front facing me right now. Here they come. Don't wait. Come now. Step out of your seats and come. They're coming. They're coming from all over the building. That's it. That's it. Come right to the front.
Never gives up. You never run down on me.
God bless you. Keep coming. This is your night. This is your night. They're still coming down the aisles.
Never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me.
Hallelujah.
Love
God love you. Look at them. They're still coming.
Never
they're still coming.
Out on me. Your love never fails. Never gives
oh,
up.
Praise God.
Never runs out on me.
Fantastic.
Your love.
God love you, sir. There's 60 or 70 people standing here to receive Jesus tonight. Maybe more. Maybe more. Maybe more. Wow. Might even be 80, bro. There's a lot here. We love you. God bless you for coming. Now listen, this is not the end of the journey. This is the beginning of a lifelong adventure in God. Come on, hallelujah. Make sure you're in church next week. Usually where you get saved is where you start going to church. Now here's what we're going to do. Now hear me out. We're going to get all of you at the front to go with this dear pastor. He's up here, this good-looking guy, sort of half-waving at you. And they're going to take you just out the side here. They're going to give you some literature to help you on the next step of the journey. They're going to pray with you. There'll be other people there. They'll get you to fill out a decision card. And you'll only be out there a few minutes, and while you're out there, the band is going to play and we're going to sing a couple of songs. And when you come back in, we're going to pray for the sick to be healed. So you won't miss out. Hallelujah. All right, bro, follow him out here right now. Don't go back to your seats. God love you. Just go out there now. Ushers, help this couple right here, this lady right here.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.